song. His word says to rejoice.
Thank you. if you want to, but somebody told you revival was here already, so. Anything, but too many people. That was a good place for me. Too many people believe that they're supposed to stay where they're at. But there's something deep down inside that rises up, a fire that rises up, a hope that rises up, that says, I am frustrated because I'm not supposed to be where I am. See, I don't know if I'm in the right place, but I'm scheduled here anyway. But I'm going to tell you, I was praying one time, and the Lord said to me, He says, why are you complaining about where you are? And I said, well, Lord, the reason is very simple, is because I don't like where I am. And He said, do you know you're supposed to be frustrated during this time? And now that didn't make sense to me. That made me go tilt. I said, frustrated? Why? He says, because if you got happy and content and comfortable with where you are right now, you would never go to the next level of glory that I have for you. Come on, there's a comfort when you get somewhere, but then after a while it gets uncomfortable. Have you ever stayed over at your in-laws? You know what I'm saying? There's a time when it's good, and then there's a time when everybody's done been fed, everybody's watched all the games, and it's about 11 o'clock at night, and everybody's looking around. Mainly the people that live there. Saying, when are they going to get up out of my house? Come on, you've been there, you know what I'm talking about. You just left somebody's house here last night, recently. But I want us to go to the Lord in prayer and understand that if you're frustrated right now, you are in a good place because you're leaving that place. Oh, you didn't hear me. I said, if you're frustrated right now, you are in a divine place that's getting ready to launch you out of that place. That frustration is going to take you to a place because you're not settled where you're at. You're not supposed to be settled there. You're supposed to go to that next level of glory. Come on, lift your hands with me. Father, in Jesus' name, we just rejoice for these services. We rejoice, Lord, for the one tomorrow and tomorrow night and all the ones this week. But Lord, we're here tonight. We've come to meet with you tonight. We need to hear a word from you tonight. We've got an assignment from you tonight. We're not here by accident. We've come to have an encounter with you. Holy Spirit, we leave here different than the way we came in. Changed and rearranged by the power of the Word of God and by the Spirit of the living God. We thank you, Lord. We do go from faith to faith and glory to glory. Let revelation flow through here into our hearts. We need a word from you tonight. We thank you, Lord. We rely on you totally. To our own understanding, but Lord, we do thank you for everything that you're working in us. We are equipped with your presence. We're equipped with your word and with your fire. In the matchless name of Jesus, and everyone shouted, amen. Well, glory to God. Well, turn with me, if you would, real quick to Matthew chapter 3. We're going to pick up where we left off last night. If you weren't here last night, we're glad you're here tonight. We'll tell you that much. And we know this, you're not a tremendous football fan, but we're glad you're here. But somebody will get that in a minute and laugh, Pastor. Yeah. But one of the things that we're excited about is that you do take the things of God seriously. There's a great, great move that's taking place in the world right now. It's not just in the United States. It's not just in Oklahoma. I believe it's here in Tulsa. There's two of us that agree. Hallelujah. I'd like to meet with you right after the service. We can talk about the Word. We're going to have a good time. Hallelujah. The rest of you don't know what's going on. Earth's going to hell in a handbasket. God bless you. Good night. Thank you for coming. No, I said there's a move that's taking place, and I believe it's happening here in Tulsa. I got better things to do than to blow fake glory of the blessed assurances of those that I'm trying to minister to. I believe with all of my heart there's a move that's taking place that's going to shake the very foundations of tradition and religion that's been in this state and in this city for so long that where they got good at playing church, now somebody's going to rise up and be the church. You don't have to be that person, but honey, you are looking at one that is. Glory to God. You are looking at a temple of the Holy Ghost. How many temples am I looking at out there? At least four or five of you. Glory to God. We got some temples of fire out there. We got some temples of glory, temples of hope, temples of power. Glory to God. I'm tired of people going and praying for people to comfort them in the fact that they can't see a miracle, so they'll just get through it. I'm here to tell you, I am looking at people that are willing to go up to hospitals and raise people from the dead just because they can. Yeah. To God be all the glory. I'm talking about taking glory for ourselves. But somewhere down the line, we got to start preaching this and hearing this and seeing it. I only got this life to see it. Oh, you're not hearing. I only have this life in this generation to see what God has called me to do. And I'm a results person. I'm going to see the results. If He said it's in that word, then I am not going to rest till I see it manifest. Feel like a cat that just used the litter box and I'm running around the place. I'm feeling wide-eyed and bushy-tailed tonight. Pastor already told me this was my last night here, so I'm going to get it all out. He didn't say nothing. All right. Well, what does 2 Corinthians say? 3rd chapter, 17th verse. Anybody remember what we were talking about? Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is... there's no bondage. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is not sickness. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is, come on, not oppression. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is, come on, it's not depression. So, brother, I'm dealing with depression. Are you saying I don't have the Holy Ghost? No, I'm not saying you don't have the Holy Ghost. I'm saying you're not letting Him rise up above that depression. Because where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. There is freedom. And I can believe that we can say this. The Lord told me this about this scripture. And He says, you're not taken away from it when you say this. But where the Spirit of the Lord is, there are results. Ooh. Yes. Come on, do you think it's just good to have pastoral care that comes up and pats you on the head when you're in a time when you need symptoms to go away and the root cause of that to go away? I appreciate you loving me. I appreciate you're there. But you know what's going to make me even more excited than knowing that you're there and that you care? Is me getting up out of that bed, saving money. You're not hearing. Saving money, not having to deal with sickness, not having any pain, and being a testimony where there was a test. Come on, I want to be able to call up my pastor when it's time, if there's a time, and say, I need you, but not for comfort. I've got the Holy Ghost. I've got the Comforter. You're not hearing me. But I've got somebody that I can call on and be in agreement with and know that this word that I'm reading about is going to manifest and have the results, not later, but now. I don't know about you, but I love those adverbs. Immediately. Suddenly. I like hearing about that, reading about that. Now faith is. I want to know that it can happen now. Let me just demonstrate. Who in here has been having any pain whatsoever? In their neck, in their arms, in their shoulder, anywhere. Okay. What are you dealing with, sister? Okay. Now listen, when I tell you to stand up, it's going to all go. Are you ready? One, two, three. Stand up. Be healed. All pain go in Jesus' name. Come on, hula hoop for us, girl. Come on, do something. Come on now. It's all gone, isn't it? Come on, be accused of dancing in church. I want somebody dancing in the National Enquirer. Well, it started out good. It started out good. I like that chord. How you doing? Somebody say now. Somebody say immediately. Somebody say suddenly. What were you dealing with, sister? Because as soon as I prayed for her, it was gone. You're him too?
Yes.
Whew, God's healing us. I love how people say that too, because it's like God only does hip night. I'm so glad you came on hip night. Come on now. God is hip, but He doesn't just do hip night on Monday night. You want to come tomorrow night, He'll do ears. No, He does it all, and you know what He did 2,000 years ago?
Yes.
That's your hip doing now.
Yes.
No pain?
Glory.
None.
Glory.
Now, did she steal her healing?
No.
Absolutely not. Did that healing ricochet off of her and into her? No, because that same God that just touched her and did it 2,000 years ago, she just received it. And you got so excited, you took your eyes off of your pain and went to see if she really got healed. And you're like, hey, mine's gone. Woo! It's been midnight. Now, come on. Look at your neighbor, touch their hip. Just kidding. Don't do it. All right, now. Oh, somebody got a hold of hers. I didn't let go. You might want to let go of that. But the thing is that God does things now because he did things then. If Jesus does it now and it appears that he's doing it now, then it's because he did it then. Now here's the wrong thinking. Wrong thinking is thinking I've got to pray to get Jesus to do something he's already done.
That's right.
Feel like messing. If Jesus already did it 2,000 years ago, then brother, are you saying I don't need to pray? Not like you have been. How did you get healed? Well, I used my faith. And wait a minute. If he hasn't done these things yet, then how could they have gotten their healing just like that? If everything he did 2,000 years ago on the cross is done and finished, and he said it is finished, I'm quoting Jesus, it is finished. When he said it is finished, that means your healing was finished. But brother, I wasn't even born yet. Ain't he good? Come on, I said, ain't he good? Isn't that how he does? Come on. He took care of your sickness, your bondage, your darkness, everything, and put it on the cross 2,000 years ago so that you could operate in freedom now. It wasn't until you started thinking right that you got the healing. Your faith was with the fact that, I don't know, he said, stand up. He looks wild. He probably hit me if I don't get up. No, seems angry. Didn't have it. Don't be ensnared. Three people got it. No, everybody got it. Three people just have bad humor. All right, good. But the thing is, you put your faith with the fact that he said, hey, there must be something going on. He said, stand up. I saw her eyes. Can I just bust you a little bit here? Can I put you on blast in a good way? Why not? I've been doing it for the last 3 minutes. You weren't really expecting it. You know how I know? Because people look like this when they get it. And I'm glad because it went past me and it went to God and it touched you. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. But we go from glory to glory even as by the Spirit of the Lord. But the thing is, if Jesus hadn't finished it 2,000 years ago, we can't get it. So our prayers have often been trying to get something we don't believe he's given yet. We're trying to get something that we're not sure in our heart has been settled yet. It's hard to think that before I was born, all my sickness, all my disease, everything, all the bondage, all the junk, all the sin of my past was actually put into his body, hung on a cross for me, just like for you before you were ever born. Because that's what makes him the same today, and we can say this, for your past, your present, and your future. So when are you healed? Right now. But I don't feel like it. That's irrelevant.
Amen. That's right.
Come on, when I worked at healing school at Rama, I'm telling you, we had crowds that were starting to build because people were getting a hold of this. They were understanding what was being said. They were starting to get it for the first time that they had been trying to get their healing either by being good enough, by fasting enough, by praying enough, by doing whatever enough that I don't understand what I'm not doing right. I've forgiven everybody and their dog. They've done everything but accept rest in the fact it's done.
Amen.
Wait a minute. I've got pain in my body. You're healed. No, I'm not. You know how I know? Because I feel the pain. Come on, you feel me?
Yes.
That's what a lot of people do. They go and they look. You don't look good. And as soon as you start to feel good, that's the day somebody said, "Are you okay?" What? What? You don't look good. And I'm like, this is the best day I've had in a week. Shut up. Come on now, I'm going somewhere with this, because a lot of people's thinking is that they have to pray hard enough to get what was given easy enough. Which is what I was saying yesterday, is we got to learn when to pray and when to say. So if symptoms come, I don't have to pray, "Lord, heal me." I say, "I am healed. Every one of you foul symptoms, get up out of my body in Jesus' name." Who's been dealing with migraine headaches on and off throughout your life? I know somebody's in here, I can feel that. And you just been dealing with headaches on and off throughout your life. And I know this, as soon as somebody gives a word of knowledge like I give, and they make them stand up and they get healed, they say, "I can live with the headache. I just don't want him to know what I did Saturday night." Oh, this is getting really, really good. You know who's laughing the hardest? The ones that had the party Saturday night. You get them, Brother Jay. Not me. When you deal with this kind of thinking, you're always thinking that it's a crapshoot. It's a rolling of the wheel, you know, spinning of the wheel, rolling of the dice. Do I get it? Do I not? Oh, so how come they got it? How come I didn't? And then you start going around because you don't feel right, because you've got pain in your body, because it's a man in here that's been dealing with the headaches on and off. I may just go right to you. You know how I do already. That's all right. I won't say nothing about Saturday night. I already busted you. But here's the thing. See how quiet it got? Because now we went from women to it's a man. That's all right. If God shows me, I'll talk to you nicely about it. I'm not going to try and embarrass you. But the worst thing that happens is you get healed. Right there, people know. You've been in my classes. People, I don't know how many times people will come up after a class and say, "That was me. Could you pray for me? That was me." But sometimes that gift is flowing. The Lord's wanting to see, are you going to man up and jump up and get it? So anyway, I'm not feeling right in my body. I've got symptoms. So I'm dealing with this in my body. What is going on? I'll get to Matthew 3. Hold on, I didn't forget where we're at, but this is good. Where am I supposed to go for help when I've got symptoms in my body? I've had a bad report. I've got doctors saying that I've got this and I've got that and I've got 3 months to live. Where do I go? Whose report will you believe? You have the choice to believe the report of the Lord or the report of the natural. The doctor's report says you've got 3 months to live. You've got pain in your body. What do I do? What do I do? I have no idea what to do. Whose report will you believe? It's not that you're being in denial about the report you've been given. It's just now you know what to stand against and use your authority. Anybody that's called me up and said, "I've been diagnosed with cancer," the first thing I tell them is, this is not a death sentence. You've got a call on your life. You are called and born to live. "Well, what do? I don't understand this." I said, "You are healed." "I don't get it. I can't be healed. I just was given a report of the doctor that's contrary to the report of the Lord." I said, "It's your choice what you believe." Now, how many times have you heard this? And I don't want to confuse you, but how many times have you heard this word? "Sister, how are you doing? How are you feeling?" Well, we know we don't go by feelings, but we go by faith. So we want to say the right things. But you say, "I'm healed." And your friend says, "But you don't look healed. You're still coughing. You're still hacking. You're still, you know, bleeding out of your nose. What's wrong? I don't understand." "I'm healed. Don't worry about it." And too many times, people will say this. Not that they're healed. Not that they're standing. They say this. "Well, I'm believing." Ooh, this is getting good too. Come on. Yeah, how many of you in here have said that? "Hey, is God taking care of your bills?" "Oh, I'm believing. I'm just believing." "Well, what about those symptoms?" "Oh, I'm believing. I'm healed." Well, let me ask you this. As believers, what do? We believe. And it's okay to believe. But somewhere in the Word, it says, and I'll go to that in just a minute, we have having the same spirit of faith. We have believed, past tense. Therefore, we have spoken. We believe, therefore we speak. Too many of us are staying in a future tense of belief called believing, but when I know I've got it, then why do I have to keep believing if I believed? Past tense. Are you healed? Oh, I'm believing I am. But you ask the right person, are you healed? I believe I'm healed. Past tense. Come on now, when you keep saying I'm believing, we could interchange these two words. Sister, how are you feeling? I'm believing I'm healed. I'm believing I'm healed. Now, I'm not trying to come against your doctrine too hard. I don't want you to shut me down all the way. But when you get a hold of this revelation, things that you've been fighting for just end up overtaking. I'm believing. We could also say it this way. Sister, are you healed? I'm hoping. Yeah! Glory to God! I'm believing for my healing. Can also be said, I'm hoping for my healing. Because the way you're saying it is the same heart and the same mentality as one that's still hoping. If you really believe you've got it, then you have it. I believe I've received, Mark 11 says. If I believe I've received, then whether you see it or not, whether I see it or not, is irrelevant. I have received is past tense. You may not think I got it, but I got it. But if you come up to me and you're still hacking and snorting and everything else, and you say, I'm believing I'm healed, I'm believing I'm getting it, all you're saying is, I'm hoping it will eventually go away. Oh, look at your neighbor and say, I know you don't like it, but I do. Look at your other neighbor and say, I know you don't like it, but this is good, so you might as well smile. Where's my organ donor on that one, man? That was some Hammond B3 all up on that thing. But no. We had it worse. I don't want to get him keyed up. Wow, they're not in the flow, are they? But Mark 11 talks about when you pray, believe you have received. When I speak to the mountain and it doesn't look like it's moved, what do? Oh, I better pray harder. I better say harder. No. That same chapter in Mark 11, Jesus comes up to a fig tree looking expectantly. Looking expectantly to receive figs off of that tree. And there's nothing. And what did he do? Don't mess with the man. Before he has his coffee, he cursed that tree. And said, no one shall eat of this tree. He cursed that tree. Did it look like anything changed? Not at first. But we're just believing something will. Come on, Jesus didn't go around saying, I'm believing that tree is cursed. I'm believing that that fig tree is cursed. No, when he said it, it was irrelevant what it looked like. He got what he was saying. He had what he said. He believed, he received. Now, where does faith come from? Faith comes from having heard, hearing the Word of God, hearing the Word of God, hearing the Word of God. Where does faith come from? The Word, and hearing the Word of God, and hearing the Word of God. When Jesus spoke, this tree is cursed, who was there listening? Besides the fig tree, the disciples. So the disciples heard the Word from the Word, should have had faith for that thing which was said, which was what? This fig tree is cursed. Well, if their faith was there, how come the next day that they saw the fig tree, Peter goes, look, Jesus, Master, the fig tree that you cursed, look, it worked. I may not be connecting, but I'm feeling like at least one person's getting it in here. Come on. He said this fig tree is cursed, And the disciples heard it, therefore faith should have been there for the same thing that Jesus had. But isn't that funny? This proves right here that you can keep hearing the word and hearing the word, but it's how you hear that determines whether you have faith. That's what Hebrews says. How you hear determines the faith level that you get. Because we have row and pew and precious flock after flock hearing the same word that you're hearing, sitting next to each other. Why does one get the victory and one walks away failing? Well, don't I have the same amount of faith? Well, I like what the disciples said. Lord, increase our faith. Come on, if you increase our faith, what's the theory about increased faith? That if your faith is bigger, you can believe and do bigger things, right? But this is what Jesus said. He said this. If you had faith the size of a mustard seed, smallest seed, one of the smallest seeds known to man, he said you would say unto this sycamore tree, against, he was right there again next to a plant. He said if somebody would say unto this sycamore tree, be plucked up by the roots, cast into the sea, it would obey you. If all you had was the faith the size of a mustard seed. Are you trying to tell me that through all the camp meetings, through all the seminars, through all the classes, through all the services, through all the TBN, through all the inspiration channels, through all the CDs, through all the DVDs, through all the books, through all your study, you ain't got faith the size of a mustard seed yet? Woo! Look at your neighbor and say, you got itty bitty faith. If you don't have a neighbor, move to one that you know you can whip so you can say these things. Say, you got itty-bitty faith, but isn't that funny? He said, even with itty-bitty faith, you can move sycamore trees. So what does he say? He's saying, you don't need more faith. You need to do more with what you've got. So, brother, I'm just believing. Is that wrong? No, you start where you start. But according to Hebrews 11:1, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So I'm going to tell you this. As long as you're believing, you're staying in a state of hope. And I will say this. Part of your faith is hope. But I will say this. You can have hope with no faith. But you cannot have faith without hope. I'll say it again. You can have hope with no faith. That means it keeps you in a state of it's coming. It's going to be there. I'm telling you, if I hear one more preacher talk about the coming move, I'm going to just sit there and say, you know, move aside for those that are moving. I'm not being arrogant. I'm not being rude. But I'm telling you, I am desperate for what God's doing. I am not here to play games anymore. We've done it. We've done the politics. We've done the games. And now after seeing God move the way he's been moving, I'm like, he's really wanting to saturate the houses that are called house of God. And you are the ones he's going to do it through. That may not get you as excited as I'd hoped, but he's still going to do it through you. He's still going to do it through you. Do you remember in Matthew 14 when Jesus said to Peter, he said, you of little faith, where did you doubt? Wait a minute. He's giving him a lesson about his lack of faith, isn't he? Well, if you read that traditionally, you certainly would think that. But what he's saying is this, you of little faith, that got out of the boat in the midst of a storm, you with the little faith who stood on the water, you of little faith that began to take those steps towards me on the water, you of little faith who've never walked on water before, come on, you of the little faith that you have stood right in front of me, you with the little faith still allowed the seed of fear to rise up and overtake the little faith you had. Come on, what was the word he said? He said, come. That is the only word he said. And it says, one word from God can change your life forever. One word from God was enough for Peter to get out of a boat and walk on water. One word from God built his faith to such a level that faith rose up on the inside of him and created such a lightness that he began to walk on water and stood in front of the one that gave him faith. Come on. And when he looked at Jesus, he walked on water. But when he looked at the storm, began to sing. No, you're too late now. But I'm going to tell you. I'm just teasing you guys. That was good. Notice she's only playing cymbals now, not even touching the snare. Now I'm looking forward to seeing what she will use. I mentioned the snare and the cymbals. She did an awesome job last night leading, didn't she? The fear overtook his faith. Oh, I don't have time. I may cover it again later this week. I don't have time tonight. Yes, I do. That's where we're supposed to go, Matthew 14. Praise the Lord. Oh, he is so good. Are you getting anything out of this tonight? Yes, 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 yes. Dealing with water walkers in here. I believe there are those that walk on water, and I believe there are those that throw water on those on fire. But in verse 22, straightway Jesus constrained his disciples to get into a ship and go before him unto the other side while he sent the multitudes away. One of the biggest keys to walking in the supernatural. Is to hit the cymbal. One of the biggest keys to operating in the supernatural and to see miracles and results is to do what Jesus just did here, which is what? He got rid of all distractions. He got rid of his disciples, not in the sense of, he took them out. He got rid of them in the sense of, go to the other side, I'll catch up with you later. Then he sent the multitude away. Wait a minute, that's who he's supposed to be ministering to. But here, I'm talking to ministers in here now. Here's where the problem of effective ministry comes in. Most of our ministries are not as effective as they should be or could be. It's because we don't know when to send the ones we're ministering to away. I like what Dr. Cho says. Dr. Cho is a pastor of one of the largest churches in the world in Seoul, Korea. He's got almost a million member church. I was joking with somebody the other day when we were talking about all the members he had. I said, man, if he had a church split, he'd probably be thankful. If he even noticed. I'm like, well, how can you have a potluck dinner with a church that big? A through F, come on Monday night. G through I, come on Tuesday night. Sorry if your name is W through Z because you may not get no barbecue. All right, but anyway, so the point is he's got a million member church. He says, I get up hours every day before I ever meet with anyone so that I can have wisdom with the ones that I meet with. He says, they're coming with real problems. I've got to have real answers. And he said this too. He goes, I spend hours with God and minutes with men. He said, too many ministers are spending minutes with God and hours with men. You want to show me a minister that's burned out? I'll show you one that's been spending too much time with the people he's ministering to. I didn't say he didn't minister to them. It's just you want to minister effectively? I'd rather have 5 minutes with a person and effectively minister to them instead of spending 5 days on vacation and we didn't go anywhere.
That's right.
Is it okay to stand on the pew? But here in Matthew 14, he got rid of all distractions. And in verse 23, when he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into a mountain apart to pray. And what did we say yesterday? How did mountains know when to obey Jesus? How did mountains know when he used that example, if anyone shall say unto this mountain, be removed, be cast into the sea. Don't doubt in your heart, but believe that those things that you say come to pass. You will have whatever you say if you've been a good student of the Word. No, he said you can have whatever you say. How do mountains know to obey? Why did he use that as an illustration? Because he'd been up in those mountains praying, and those mountains were eavesdropping on how powerful those times of prayer were.
Amen.
Yes. I'm feeling ornery tonight. He goes on to say this. When he had sent the multitudes away, he went up into a mountain apart to pray and to fellowship. And when the evening was come, he was there alone. A lot of people don't understand when they read this that the multitudes were so great, the distractions were so great, that he still had to separate himself to the point to where he would finally be alone. It took a while for him to get by himself. Come on, sometimes the TV screams out your name, knows you personally, and you love it back. Sometimes radio, sometimes people, sometimes hobbies, sometimes this, sometimes that. You got to sometimes get rid of all distractions, and sometimes it takes a little while, but make sure your focus is on getting apart, getting away, and getting up high above all that stuff to get with God. Then it goes on to say this. The ship was now in the midst of the sea, verse 24, tossed with waves, for the wind was contrary. And in the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went out unto them. That fourth watch was about 3 to 6 a.m. So he had spent a good deal of time praying and talking to the Father. And it says he went out unto them. Some translations say he would have kept walking on by had they not cried out to him. Now do you understand, the wind is contrary. The sea is being tossed to and fro. The waves are kicking up. A storm is there. A storm is raging. What comes with storms? Come on, anybody. Lightning. Thunder. Usually it's really dark at 3 o'clock in the morning. Because now you've got cloud covers. Now you've got rain. But isn't that funny that the disciples, although were in fear already because of the storm, when they saw Jesus walking on the water, cried out for fear, and what did they say? It is a spirit or a ghost. Now why do you suppose they said that? Most people, if they've never seen a ghost, wouldn't even know to call something a ghost. And if it's so dark out there, save maybe some flashes of lightning, but still, if it's dark out there with lightning, has anybody ever been in a good lightning storm? It blinds you for a few seconds. I mean, so how are they even seeing him in this storm, paying attention on not sinking and being afraid? The seed of fear is already working in them. I'm teaching you something tonight. I hope you get this. Turn with me over, hold your place here, and go over to Matthew 17. Just a few chapters to your right. We're going to see something here that I think is going to absolutely amaze you. If it doesn't, just act amazed, and we'll all be happy. In verse 1, after 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John and brought them up into a high mountain apart. Come on, very similar to what just happened in Matthew 14. He separated himself from the people, separated himself from the disciples, separated himself from all distractions, but it's not important enough to separate from. You've got to know you're separating to. So he gets with God. Well, now Jesus is taking them up into one of his prayer sessions. Come on, somebody. And behold, there appeared unto, well, let's go to verse 2, I'm sorry, and was transfigured, who was? Jesus, transfigured before them, and his face did shine as the sun, and his raiment was white as the light. So what happened to Jesus there in that time of prayer? The same thing we see with Moses when he went up into the mountain apart and talked with God. He started glowing. Yes. Come on. Yes. Come on. He started glowing. He was wearing the countenance of the place in the spirit he was standing. The glory saturated him. The presence of God enveloped him. He actually had to put on different clothes to go to such a high level to talk to him. And the reflection of talking to the one he was talking to so high put on him a residue of that presence of the one he was talking to. So we can say this, in those times of prayer, just like Moses. Come on, you know when he came down off the mountain. He crawled into the tent. His wife said, honey, turn the light out. You remember that? Come on. He was just glowing. Because of that time he had spent with the Lord, so was Jesus. So what do you think happened after he came down off the mountain? I believe he was still glowing. Come on now. And he's walking on the water in a glowing state, and they cried out for fear and said, give it to you anyway. Cry out for fear, saying it's a ghost. They didn't cry out for fear. It says, who's that joker walking on the water? Is he on crack? And how could they see him if it's so dark in the nighttime, so dark with the cloud covering, so dark with the rain and the storm, except his countenance had changed? So they cry out for fear, it is a ghost. And what did Jesus say? Be of good cheer, it is I. He knew they were freaking out because they're all screaming like a bunch of girls. Ah, it's a ghost! Fear was on them because of the storm. Fear was on them because they were possibly going to sink. Fear was on them because they're seeing something they hadn't seen before. They're thinking it's a ghost. Come on, if you had never seen something like that, how would you know to identify it as such? It looked like an apparition. It was the Holy Ghost. And so now, Peter is full of fear, and yet Jesus sees that, and in his grace, cries out back to them, be of good cheer, it is I. Now that doesn't make sense unless you understand that cheer is another word for joy. He's saying, get your joy back, and it'll overtake the fear that's attacking you. You show me somebody that's full of fear, I'll show you somebody that's lost their joy.
Yeah.